Sermon on the Mount. Where are you? In Matthew 5, and get this guy on, verses 11 and 12, Jesus elaborates on that eighth and final beatitude that we see in Matthew chapter 5, verse 10, calling his disciples to rejoice in persecution rather than be intimidated by it. In response to being insulted, persecuted, and slandered, Jesus says that Christians should rejoice and be glad. And the reason we should have that response is that we have a great reward in store for us, just as the prophets will be rewarded for faithfulness to God despite the persecution they endured. So disciples of Christ will be rewarded for faithfulness to Him. So that's his point about just as they treated the prophets that way. That's what he's talking about. Now, this exhortation has never been more timely, in my judgment, in the United States of America. Writing about what's going to follow the decision on Friday by the Supreme Court to constitutionalize homosexual marriage, the New Testament scholar Robert Gagnon said, well, I didn't put that slide in there, but Gagnon said, as individuals, people of faith will be aggressively indoctrinated, fined, denied advancement, fired, intimidated, and subjected to ceaseless verbal abuse in public and private schools, at institutions of higher learning, at places of employment in public and private sectors, and throughout the main communication organs of the media and entertainment industry. Their institutions and businesses will be set on a collision course with the state, denied government funding, contracts and loans, denied accreditation and tax-exempt status, and subjected to government harassment. And I think that's only the beginning, you see. And we must strengthen ourselves and ourselves be ready to rejoice and be glad. And we must train our children and our grandchildren to likewise be ready to rejoice and be glad. The church is entering an anti-Christian social environment more like the first and second century than I think anything we've ever experienced. Now, Jesus talking and having instructed his disciples to rejoice in persecution by focusing on the great reward that's in store for them, for those who endure in faith, he then warns them about two other reactions persecution might produce. And he brings this up and does this, addresses this in Matthew 5, 13 through 16. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13, he says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet." Now, as you know, salt had a number of uses in the ancient world, the vast majority of which were very beneficial. I mean, salt was like, you know, a miracle drug kind of thing. Had many uses, almost all of them beneficial. It was then, as today, it was a seasoning that vastly improved the flavor of food. It also seems to have served some kind of hygienic function, some kind of function in the case of newborns, whether it was as a cleansing solution or whether it was to retard bacteria and thus retard odor in the child's swaddling cloth. It had those uses, but its most critical function in the ancient world was as a preservative. It slowed the decay of meat, which in the days before refrigeration, you can understand how important that was. I can keep something to eat around longer, so when I have it, I can preserve it. So that was its most critical function in the ancient world. And whether one focuses on salt's use as a only on that use as a preservative, whether you focus only on that, or whether you include in the reference its other beneficial uses, the quality of salt under consideration in the Lord's metaphor here is the powerful and positive effect it has on that to which it is applied. So whether you think he's focusing only on it being a preservative, or you think these hygienic function, or the other functions of salt as something to flavor food, it has a powerful and positive beneficial effect on that to which it is applied. And Jesus says to his disciples in 5:13 that they are the salt of the earth. because in living the way that he calls them to live, they will have a powerful and positive effect on the world. They will benefit the world. They will be a blessing to the world. And they will be that by influencing its standards and practices. They will transform the world so as to bless its inhabitants. And we've seen that, and we've talked about that, and how under Christian influence, what has happened? Child abuse and all those things of abandoning infants, all those things, how people view infants changed. Ultimately, slavery changed. And so you're going to be a beneficial use to the world. You're going to be a blessing to the world, but also you'll be a blessing and, of course, drawing people into the kingdom of God. So he says, you're the salt of the earth. In living as disciples, you will have a powerful and positive effect on this world. But he adds the warning that if Christians abandon the faith, if they abandon the faith and thus surrender their distinctive character and ethics, if they become tasteless or unsalty salt, if they return to being like the world in the hope of deflecting the hostility and persecution about which he's been speaking, they cease to be of any benefit to the world. They cease to be of a benefit to the world. If instead of rejoicing and being glad in the face of insult and persecution and slander, they jettison their distinctiveness and blend back in with the world, if they fall away, they're suitable only to be discarded, only thrown out in the street. And that's pretty powerful language for what's in store. And the language in the second part of verse 13, it seems to move beyond the loss of benefit that they as faithful disciples would have on the world to indicating that the apostates themselves, those who have abandoned the faith, will be subject to divine condemnation. See, the suggestion that salt that has lost its saltiness, when he says, how? The suggestion that salt that has lost its saltiness cannot regain it. Well, that's a way, see, of putting the danger of apostasy in its starkest terms. He's putting the danger of this in its starkest terms. In other words, it's like the later writer of Hebrews does. In Hebrews chapter 6, verses 4 through 6, I think Jesus is doing the same thing. He's giving a worst case scenario to fortify the point about the danger. Now, we know that Christians can alienate themselves from God by sinning and yet still be able to return in repentance. We know that. And we can see that in a number of places. In our vernacular, you see, or for example, the disfellowshipped are not in fellowship with God. That's why they're disfellowshipped. They have decided, I'm abandoning God. And so they are then disfellowshipped in recognition of that, but the act of disfellowshipping is intended to what? To move them to repentance so that they can be brought back into fellowship with God and His people. That's what disfellowshipping is about. It's not mean. It's an act of love toward people. And so we know that people can be alienated by sinning and still repent and be restored to fellowship with God and with the body. But there is a step beyond that. There is a step beyond that degree of alienation, a state in which the person deliberately has chosen to end permanently his relationship with Jesus. You know, we would say that they have declared that Jesus is dead to me and meant it. That's how we'd put it. They've declared Jesus is dead to me and they've meant it. And at that point, we might say that one's repenting apparatus has been permanently disabled. They cannot be restored. They cannot be made salty again because they won't be restored. You see, their repenting apparatus has been disabled. They have made a final open-eyed rejection of the Lord Jesus. And that's why Jesus, I think, he raises the specter of this by way of a rhetorical question. You see, he raises that specter by way of a rhetorical question. He says, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? He raises the stakes, you see, in the apostasy against which he's warning. So he gives a worst case scenario, just like the writer of Hebrews does. It raises that possibility and that specter by saying, you know, this is where this can end. Or you can't come back. And that's what I think he's doing there and warning them. Then he says in chapter 5, 14 to 16, you are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Light is a symbol of righteousness and enlightenment. In John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus says of himself, "What? I am the light of the world." You see, righteousness and enlightenment. The Lord Jesus is the light of the world. And Christians are to be the light of the world, in that we are to show the light of Christ in the way that we live. Paul says in Ephesians 5, particularly in verse 8, but he says, therefore, do not be sharers with them, for you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, ascertaining what is pleasing to the Lord, and do not participate in the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. He says in Philippians chapter 2, especially verse 15, he says, beginning in 14, do everything without complaints and arguments, in order that you may be faultless and pure, unblemished children of God in the midst of a crooked and perverted generation, in which you shine as lights in the world. You see, that's what Jesus is calling about. He says, holding fast the word of life so as to provide ground for glorying for me on the day of Christ, so that I did not run in vain nor labor in vain. You see, a city on a hill and a lighted lamp, they relate to Christians being the light of the world, and that just as concealment is incompatible with the nature of a city on a hill. You see, you have here up there, whether it's at night and you see lights, torches, or whether it's the gleaming white limestone, concealment is incompatible with the nature of a city on a hill, and concealment is contrary to the purpose of a lighted lamp. So just as those things are true, concealment is incompatible with the nature of a Christian, and it's contrary to a Christian's purpose. A living faith in Jesus Christ, a true biblical living faith in Jesus Christ, will inevitably express itself. It will inevitably result in a transformed life. It cannot be concealed. A faith that does not manifest itself in works, that is not transforming, is what James calls a dead faith. It's not a genuine, biblical, saving faith. It is a dead faith. It is mere intellectual assent. Simply believing certain things are true without surrendering to those truths. And he says that is insufficient to save. But a true saving faith inevitably transforms a person's life, or leads to that transformation. If it's concealed, you see, if the person's faith is concealed, if it makes no observable difference in a person's life, it is not a biblical saving faith. That is contrary to the nature of biblical saving faith. Moreover, concealing one's Christian life is contrary to our role as a source of light in the world. Right? Concealing one's Christian life is contrary to our role, that we are to be a light in the world. It makes no more sense to hide one's Christ-motivated righteousness from other people than to put a lamp under a basket where it can't fulfill the purpose for which it was lit. I mean, who would do that? Who lights something to provide light and then conceals the light? And so that's what he's talking about. He says to do that is contrary to the purpose that you were given. And that is to be what? That is to be light for the world. Rather, Christians are to live openly exemplary lives. We are to live openly exemplary lives not to parade our goodness, not to draw attention to ourselves, as you know he will tell very clearly soon, that that kind of thing and that kind of motivation is no good. But not to draw attention to ourselves, aren't we wonderful, but to direct attention to God, who is the source of this living and is the source of every good gift. So he tells them that this is what they're to be. They are the light of the world. You see, they're the light of the world. Now, Jesus is here warning. As I understand this, he is warning about the temptation to go underground with one's faith, to be a secret Christian, which is a predictable response to the hostility of persecution about which he's been speaking. One can abandon the faith and cease to be salty salt, or one can try to go underground and conceal one's faith in the hope of deflecting the pressure of persecution. One can try to hide that one is in fact a disciple and believer in Jesus Christ. And Jesus is saying that that's not an option. You see, if instead of rejoicing and being glad in the face of insult, persecution, and slander, we seek to hide our Christian distinctive, in doing that, we are subverting our mission. Because our mission is what? It's to be light of the world. So if we say, let me go under the basket here, what are we doing? We're subverting our mission. And so that's what I think, and that's how I think it flows from his expansion on that final beatitude, what he's talking about there. Now, if I may digress, I'm afraid that some of us have gotten the idea that rather than living holy lives in the world and before the world, that we should live like the world. See, so as not to appear self-righteous or to scare off potential recruits by making them think they're going to have to change. We don't want to do that. You see, we want to kind of get them here so they don't think that Christ's call is anything radical. That it's this idea of a call to come and die, to give up who you are and to follow him as Lord. Now, you see, people don't want to hear that. They'll be afraid of that. So we want to kind of muffle that. And say, no, we're just like you. Just like you. Live the same way you do. You see, and that's a temptation, and I think we've gotten that idea. But guess what? Christ calls us to change. He does, in fact, as I say, he calls us to come and die, and we cannot strip that out of the gospel and pretend that we still have the gospel. We cannot do that. I mean, after all, Jesus did say in Luke 14, 26 and 27, if anyone comes to me and does not hate, Semitic idiom for love less, if anyone does not hate his own father and mother, his wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he can't be my disciple. I mean, do you see how radical it is? He cannot be my disciple. I have to be the top. The ultimate prior, whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. And he insisted on being upfront about what was required. See, right after declaring that he has to be the supreme priority in a disciple's life, he says in 14, 28 to 30, for which of you desiring to build a tower doesn't first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he's laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. He said, you have to go into this open-eyed. You have to go into this understanding what I call you to. You don't get to create a third path that says, I'm going to do this. I'm going to call this Christianity and call this discipleship where I continue to sit on the throne of my life. He said, you got to pick. You got to choose. And so that's the truth of the matter. And we don't do nobody favors, you see, by trying to muffle that. There is a call. And let me tell you, the truth of the matter is that many people want desperately to change. They want to change. They want the power that Christ gives through the Holy Spirit to live a new life. A life that is no longer enslaved to sin. They want this. They hunger for this. And when we downplay the radicalness of Christian living, when we muffle the truth of a new life in Jesus Christ, I think we reduce the appeal of Christianity, because I think that call to hope of new life, that God loves you so much, He will not leave you where you are. I think that enhances Christianity's appeal. But there apparently are people that see it differently, and so now you know how I see it. But he says here in Matthew 5, 17 to 20, he says, "Do not think I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Now in 5:17, Jesus tells them not to think that he's come to abolish the law or the prophets. See, in bringing the kingdom of God, in inaugurating, instituting the kingdom of God, he was not rejecting or setting aside God's prior revelation in Scripture. On the contrary, he came to fulfill that Scripture. He wasn't rejecting it or setting it aside. He was fulfilling it. And the word that's rendered in the ESV and in many other English translations, abolished, that word is used in connection with the demolishing of buildings. I mean, that gives you an idea of what you're talking about. See, the demolishing of building that's used three other times in Matthew 24, verse 2, it refers to the temple complex being torn down. It refers to that. In Matthew 26, 61 and 27, 40, it refers to the destruction of the temple. It carries this sense of scrapping, doing away with, just destroying. So Jesus said, "I didn't come to do that. I came to fulfill the Old Testament scriptures." The phrase, "the law and the prophets," that phrase is a common designation for the Hebrew scriptures, what we call the Old Testament. You can see that in Matthew 7, 12, 22, 40, Luke 16, 16, Acts 13, 15, Romans 3, 21. But the unusual phrase that Jesus uses here, he uses the phrase, "the law or the prophets." He says, yeah, you had a very stock phrase, "law and the prophets," that's the Hebrew scriptures. But he says, "the law or the prophets." Now, he may have done that because his opponents accused him most specifically of abolishing the law. You see, that was the thing there. They're saying, look, you know, the law code, the first five books, that's really what you're abolishing, Jesus. And so his opponents accused him of that, so maybe he's saying it that way. That they accused him that, by the way, not because he broke the law. He didn't break the law. He only sometimes broke their erroneous interpretations of the law, such as their restriction on healing on the Sabbath. For he has to show to him. He said, "Wait a minute now. You're willing to go rescue an animal? So don't you already understand that it's okay for me to do this great work in this person's life on the Sabbath to do good?" So he would sometimes violate their erroneous interpretations. But he didn't break the law. As Charles Quarles in his book on the Sermon on the Mount, he puts it this way, that what Jesus was saying, and I think this is good. He says, "Do not think I came to destroy the law or the prophets either, for that matter." You see, I think that's why he does it this way. Because they focused on his thing of law. He said, "I didn't come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm down with the whole Old Testament, because it's all revelation from God. I'm down with all of it." You see, and as Quarles adds, he says the statement affirmed Jesus' fidelity to the entire Old Testament. See, just as marriage doesn't abolish courtship or engagement, but fulfills or accomplishes its purpose, so Jesus didn't reject or scrap the Old Testament, but he fulfilled it. He fulfilled it. The entire Old Testament pointed forward to Jesus and to the kingdom of God he was ushering in. All of these scriptures have this forward look to them about Jesus and what is God doing in the working. Where is he taking creation? How is he restoring his fallen creation, his sin-sick creation? All of it is pointing toward what? Towards his ultimate work and rescue, the pivot point of which is the Lord Jesus Christ. So all of it points in that direction. As Jesus said in Matthew 11:13, all the prophets and the law prophesied. All of the scriptures had a forward point to them. And Jesus is saying, I'm the fulfiller of all of that. Matthew 5:18, it begins with the word for. See, showing that it explains and confirms the truth of verse 17, which is that he came to fulfill rather than to abolish the scripture. See, contrary to the notion that he's abolishing God's written revelation, Jesus affirms that the Old Testament will continue to stand as God's word, continue to have relevance and significance to disciples until heaven and earth in their present form give way to the new heavens and new earth that Peter speaks about in 2 Peter chapter 3, until every promise and prediction of the scriptures is completely fulfilled. Until that time, no part of Israel's inspired writings will be rendered useless or of no effect. They're not to be ignored or discarded, but they're still to be read and profited from. Quarles, in that book I mentioned on the Sermon on the Mount, he says, the OT is of enduring significance and will not be out of date, passé, or useless. Now, you'd have to understand and see what, you know, there's a sense in which part of it's obsolete, and I'll talk about that in a second, or useless so long as the universe remains in its present state. So Jesus is saying here that the Old Testament, all of the Old Testament, will remain relevant, and we treat it that way, right? Don't we say this is the Word of God? We don't disrespect the Old Testament and say, well, that, you don't have to think about that anymore. No, it's still relevant to us. It's still the Word of God and stands as the Word of God. But, as is clear from what Jesus will say in verse 21 and following, Old Covenant revelation will have a different force and application in the new setting of the fulfiller's arrival. It will have a new force and application in the new setting of the fulfiller's arrival. See, with the dawn of the new age, with the introduction of the kingdom of God, a page has turned in salvation history, in God's outworking of his plan to rescue and redeem a fallen creation. The Old Testament, it remains in effect as God's word, but it's now interpreted and functions in light of the Christ event. Old covenant scripture, it applies differently in the new covenant era, but since that application and difference was intended by God, recognizing that fact is not destroying Scripture. It's knowing the season of God's unfolding plan, and it's reading Scripture in the context of its fulfillment. That's not destroying it. That's treating it correctly. That's treating it as intended. But you see, there is a difference in force and application in light of the fulfiller's arrival. Jesus was not a Marcionite. You know, Marcion was a second century heretic who said that God of the Old Testament, he was a lower God. He was the demiurge. And he stripped away and said, that's no good. All of the Old Testament stuff is no good. That's not from the higher God, Jesus. Well, Jesus isn't that way. Jesus isn't a Marcionite. He's not anti-Old Testament. And he's not anti-law, rather he's pro-Old Testament and pro-law as properly applied. Pro-Old Testament and pro-law as properly applied. New Testament scholar Douglas Moo, he says the Old Testament law is not to be abandoned. Indeed, it must continue to be taught, 5:19. but interpreted and applied in light of its fulfillment by Christ. In other words, it stands no longer as the ultimate standard of conduct for God's people, but must always be viewed through the lenses of Jesus' ministry and teaching. You see, Jesus is the prism through which the Old Testament is to be understood. So when Jesus says in verse 19 that anyone who relaxes one of the least of these Old Testament commandments will be called least in the kingdom of heaven, he's referring to Old Testament commandments as applicable to kingdom participants, as applicable in light of his coming and fulfilling of the Old Testament. Some commands do not apply in the new covenant by virtue of his fulfilling work. For example, sacrifices. Some of those commands do not apply. He has completely fulfilled them in himself. You have that. But other commands, they have a renewed applicability. And indeed, they find their fullest expression in the Lord's teaching, which is what we're going to see in verses 21 down. He says about murder. You've already said, don't murder. Right? That's right out of the Ten Commandments. But he says, I'm going to tell you what's really going on. I'm going to give you the fulfillment of God's heart and will on that. You see, I'm telling you that anger is prohibited. What, is it that murder? Yes, I don't know the law, but I'm here as the fulfiller, and I'm going to give you the deeper, truer meaning, disciple righteousness. That's what I'm going to do, you see. Now, Donald Hagner, he says, another New Testament scholar, Hagner says, what is being emphasized in this way is not the minutiae of the law that tended to captivate the Pharisees, but simply full faithfulness to the law as it is expounded by Jesus. Thus, the phrase, the least of these commandments, refers to the final and full meaning of the law, but taken up and interpreted by Jesus, as, for example, in the material that begins in verse 21. He is the prism. The fulfiller is here, and he's the prism through which we understand that law. And as our Lord comes as the fulfiller, the one to whom all things pointed, he comes and he says, let me bring this to full flower. This is what this means for kingdom living. This is how radical the call is for my disciples. He gives this fuller meaning. You see, that's what's going on. Craig Blomberg, another New Testament scholar, he says, with the coming of Christ, many aspects of the law are brought to complete fruition. For example, the need for sacrifices, on which, see Hebrews. In other instances, certain requirements of the law endure until Christ's coming again. Classically, love of neighbor and God. Well, that's Old Testament, right? We sometimes get an idea of the Old Testament. I'm thinking, do we read it? Do we understand what God is calling for? Oh no, all God cared about them was some kind of, just a stiff formality. He didn't care. What? What? But you see in here this idea, that obviously carries on. And there are other things you see that find their fullest expression in the new covenant. In short, Christian application of the Old Testament must always take into account both the continuities and the discontinuities with the New Testament. Given this hermeneutic, this interpretive process or grid, you see, correct teaching and practice of all these commandments, verse 19 almost certainly referring back to the Old Testament law just mentioned, are crucial. Jesus will give six illustrations of such correct interpretation shortly. Verses 21 through 48. Now given the Old Testament's ongoing relevance, you see in verse 19, he says, therefore, given its ongoing relevance, obedience to God's will, as expressed in the Old Testament, and mediated to Christians through the impact of Christ's coming, remains important in the new covenant. It remains important in the new covenant. Those who practice and teach those mediated commands. You see, those commands as applied through the prism of Jesus. Those who do practice and teach those things will be called great in the kingdom. And those who do not practice them and teach them teach others to do likewise, they will be called least in the kingdom. You see, so this indicates, by the way, that there'll be some kind of gradations in the kingdom, right? Greatest and least. And you see that in other places. You see that, for example, in Matthew 20, verse 23, and in Luke 12, 47 and 48. This suggestion that there are gradations of some kind in the kingdom. This distinction between the least and the greatest. Now, it's not clear, you see, whether these gradations refer to ultimate rewards to the consummated kingdom, or do they refer to life in the kingdom now in terms of discipleship? He doesn't say, but certainly suggests that there are gradations, and in terms of the consummated kingdom, I think it will be an eternal joy to hear on that day, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Oh, I think that'll be good. And I also think that we will regret if we should wind up saying we should have been more diligent about certain obedience in certain areas. You see, so I this idea we sometimes get that Christ somehow doesn't care. He's lax about obedience. And I know where it stems from. I know where it comes from, this warped and twisted sense that somehow by obeying we earn our standing with God. That's baloney. Okay, Ray Charles can see that. All right, that's just baloney. But that's not what we're talking about. The option isn't then, I don't care about obeying. That God doesn't really care about it. He's just, you know, he's just blasé about it. He's not. He's very interested in our obedience. In chapter 5, verse 20, Jesus says that unless their righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, they will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Unless it exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you'll never enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, as Quarles says, the term righteousness and related words in Matthew consistently refer to a person's obedience to God's commands and conformity to his character expressed in personal behavior, speech, and attitudes. In other words, it refers to how one lives. It refers to personal conduct, personal righteousness, rather than to imputed righteousness. Indeed, that's the context of the statement. He's talking about keeping God's commandments. And he says, I'm telling you, unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. You see, his point is that the righteousness of true disciples, necessarily will surpass the righteousness that is typical of too many scribes and Pharisees. If it does not, then they are not true disciples and thus will not enter the kingdom of heaven. You see, the righteousness of disciples, it involves a different kind of righteousness. It involves a different kind of righteousness. See, it's different than that which characterized the scribes and Pharisees. Yes, the scribes and Pharisees, they put much effort into their religion, and they were scrupulous in their outward observance of regulations. Who can deny that? Who can deny that? But their religion was external and formal instead of a religion of the heart. Jesus says in Luke 16, the Pharisees who were lovers of money heard all these things and they ridiculed him. And he said to them, you are those who justify yourselves before men, but God knows your hearts. He knows your hearts. He knows what all you're doing and all this, but he knows what's in here. You see, for what is exalted among men is an abomination in God's sight. Jesus said in Matthew 23, 27 to 28, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you're like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and all uncleanness. So you also outwardly appear. Very diligent, very careful. Oh, I'm doing all this. Outwardly appear righteous to others, but within. But within, you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. They were more concerned with the ceremonial than with the moral. As Jesus says in Matthew 23, 23, 25, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you tithe mint, dill, and cumin, and you have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness. I'm doing all this stuff. But look, what have you neglected? Justice, mercy, faithfulness. You blind guides straining out a gnat and swallowing a camel. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. Hypocrite, you clean the outside of the cup and the plate, but inside they're full of greed or from greed and self-indulgence. So you start to see what he's talking about when he says, unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees, you won't enter the kingdom of heaven. This is what he's talking about. You see, it was a religion of man-made rules based upon concessions. They granted one another in violation of the law they pretended to keep. He says in Matthew 15, 3-9, he answered them, and why do you break the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition? For God commanded, honor your father and your mother, and whoever reviles father and mother must surely die. But you say, you don't want to be on the other side of that. God says, but you say. You see, he says, but you say, if anyone tells his father or his mother, yeah, well, what you to gain from me is given to God. I've pledged it. So I get to keep using it, but I can't give it to you. You see, I've pledged it. He need not honor his father. So for the sake of your tradition, you've made void the word of God. You hypocrites! Well did Isaiah prophesy of you when he said, this people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. You see, this is what he's talking about. That this cannot be the case of disciples. We cannot be this way. In summary, they were interested only in specifics and not in principles, only in actions and not in motives, and only in doing and not in being. You see, and we cannot be that way. That's not true of disciples. That's not true of kingdom participants. We are inwardly transformed people, those to whom God has given a new heart. So our righteousness flows from inside out. We're the people of the new covenant, kingdom people, spirit-possessed people who've been regenerated and given this new heart. It flows from the inside out. It's not external or formalistic, but it captures the spirit as well as the letter of the law. You see? Not anti-law, not anti-rules. So you hear people, oh, rules. Well, if rules are God's will, then they're good and right and holy. Right? And so it's not that. It's not we just dispense with those, but it is we capture the spirit as well as the letter of the law. You see this clearly in the righteousness to which Jesus calls the disciples in the following verses. When he gets down to it, illustrating kingdom righteousness, you're going to see how radical it is, how heart level it is, how transformed it is. He's going deep. The Lord's going deep. Wherever you are, he's going in there. And he's calling us as disciples. This is how we are to be. These are the people that we are to be. R.T. France, a New Testament scholar, he says, if I can get it to work, Jesus is not talking about beating the scribes and Pharisees at their own game, but about a different level or concept of righteousness altogether. Donald Hagner says in his commentary on Matthew, the surpassing righteousness of Christians is a new and higher kind of righteousness that rests upon the presence of the eschatological kingdom, the kingdom of God that Jesus has ushered in, the pulling into the now of the not yet. As he pulled this into now so that we live in kingdom times. Yes, is there an overlap of ages? Yes, I know that. That was what the first class was all about. I know that. But we do not deny that the kingdom of God is a present reality. And so this is what he says there. In the presence of the eschatological kingdom, he, Jesus, brings and finds its definition and content in his definitive and authoritative exposition of the law. So it is these things in the Old Testament scripture that are applicable to us as kingdom participants that find their fullest expression in the one who is the fulfiller of all Old Testament scripture. And you and I are taught that as disciples, and he calls us, I heard that bell, He calls us as disciples to come and live such radical lives before the world that our light may shine, that we may be salt. We are not to live like the world in any way, shape, form. We are to be radically righteous people. And he's going to spell that out. And I'll be back next week, Lord willing. Thank you.